Assalamu alaikum class. Today in this lecture we will discuss and learn about the swim bladder of a fish.
How we can define a swim bladder? It is an internal gas filled organ that contributes to the ability of many bony fish to control their buoyancy or upthrust or upward force, thus to stay at their current water depth without having wastage of energy in swimming. It not help cartilaginous fish in controlling their buoyancy. Now we will discuss about the term buoyancy. Buoyancy or upthrust is an upward force exerted by a fluid that opposes the weight of a partially or fully immersed object. In a column of fluid, pressure increases with depth as a result of the weight of the overlying fluid. Thus, the pressure at the bottom of a column of fluid is greater than at the top of the column. Similarly, the pressure at the bottom of an object submerged in a fluid is greater than at the top of the object. So, the pressure difference results in a net upward force on the object. And this net upward force is termed as buoyancy. It not help cartilaginous fish in controlling their buoyancy because swim bladder is absent in cartilaginous as well as the jawless fishes like lampreys and hagfish. Therefore, it is not involved in controlling their buoyancy. Now, if we talk about the location of the swim bladder. The swim bladder or air bladder of a fish is situated dorsal to the coelom between the alimentary canal and the vertebral column or backbone of the fish. It is a membranous sac containing the atmospheric gases which may vary in different types of fishes. On a portion of the surface of the bladder, there is a vascular and glandular area known as the retimirebile, or it is also known as miraculous network, which is a rich network of blood capillaries, or a gas gland or red gland. The swim bladder is evolutionary homologous to the lungs according to Charles Darwin. Homologous means that the swim bladder is similar in position, structure and evolutionary origin, but it is not necessarily in function. So Darwin reasoned that the lung in air breathing vertebrates had derived from a more primitive swim bladder. We can simply say that the swim bladder occupies the same position as the lungs of higher vertebrates and is regarded as homologous to the lungs. But it differs from the lungs of higher forms mainly in origin and blood supply. The swim bladder, because arises from the dorsal wall of the gut and gets the blood supply usually from the dorsal aorta, while the vertebrate lungs originates from the ventral wall of the pharynx and receives blood from the sixth aortic arch. Now if we talk about the position of swim bladder, as you can see here in the diagram that the swim bladder of a fish is usually present between the gut and the kidneys of a fish. You can see here that the kidney of a fish and the gut or the tract of a fish. The swim bladder lies in between these two structures. Swim bladder is called by various other names, like it is also known as gas bladder or air bladder or fish maw. Fish maw in Chinese language. What is a fish maw? Fish maw is dried swim bladders of large fishes like sturgeon, and it is despite being seemingly an inferior fish product to many. But fish maw is exalted in the Chinese community as a delicacy. It is also a good source of collagen used in food industry to create water resistant glue. Its spongy texture allows it to absorb the flavors of other ingredients also. Fresh fish maw is cleaned, dried, and occasionally deep fried. Now, the swim bladder may be present or absent in some fishes, like in jawless fishes such as lampreys and hagfishes, as well as the cartilaginous fishes such as sharks, skates, and rays. Swim bladder is totally absent. But in case of bony fishes, swim bladder is present, with few exceptional cases such as flat fishes. These are the examples of some of the flat fishes which do not have swim bladder, like sole, brill, dab, plaice, flounder, and turbot. Sharks, this is the diagram of the sharks which do not have swim bladder. Sharks, together with rays and skates, make up the subclass Elasmobranchii of the Condorichthyes class. Sharks differ from other elasmobranchs, however, resemble ordinary fishes in the fusiform shape of their body and in the location of their gill clefts on each side of the head. Though there are exceptions, sharks typically have a tough skin that is dull gray in color and is roughened by tooth-like scales. They also usually have a muscular, asymmetrical, upturned tail, pointed fins, and a pointed snout extending forward and over a crescentic mouth set with sharp triangular teeth. Sharks have no swim bladder and must swim perpetually to keep from sinking to the bottom. There are more than 400 living species of sharks, taxonomically grouped into 14 to 30 families according to different authorities. And several larger species can be dangerous to humans. Numerous sharks are fished commercially. However, overfishing in the late 20th and early 21st centuries substantially reduced the population of some shark species. This is the second group of fishes which do not have a swim bladder, and these are also the cartilaginous fishes. Skates are any of numerous flat-bodied cartilaginous fishes constituting the order Rajiformes. Skates are found in most parts of the world, from tropical to near Arctic waters and from the shallow to depths of more than 2700 meters. Most classifications distribute skates among approximately 25 genera across three families, while other place all skates into family Rajidae. Skates are rounded to diamond shaped in form. They have large pectoral fins extending from or nearly from the snout to the base of the slender tail, and some have sharp noses produced by a cranial projection, the rostral cartilage. Skates may be solid colored or patterned. Most have spiny or thorn-like structures on the upper surface, and some have weak electrical organs which may be used in communication in the tail. Typical skates, Rajidae, have the majority of living forms, and they have two dorsal fins on the tail. This is the third example of fishes which do not have a swim bladder, that is rays. Rays are the cartilaginous fishes which belong to the superorder Betoidae, and they are commonly known as rays. They and their close relatives, the sharks, comprise the subclass Elasmobranchii. Rays are the largest group of cartilaginous fishes, with well over 600 species in 26 families. Rays are distinguished by their flattened bodies, enlarged pectoral fins that are fused to the head, and gill slits that are placed on their ventral surfaces. Here you can see the image of lamprey, which are the ancient extant lineage of jawless fishes. belonging to family Petromyzontidae. All lampreys of the northern hemisphere belongs to this family. The name Petromyzontidae is derived from the Greek word petros meaning stone and myzon meaning sucking. The group name refers to a lamprey's habit of grasping a stone with its mouth to hold its position in current. The well-known destructive 1-meter-long sea lamprey occurs on both sides of the Atlantic Ocean in America and Europe. There are 24 species of lampreys in North America, of which about half are parasitic. The rest, often called brook lampreys, are species that never feed after metamorphosis and die soon after spawning. Most parasitic species do not have a major influence on the populations of their host species. All lampreys ascend freshwater streams to breed. Marine forms are anadromous, which means that they leave the sea where they spend their adult lives to swim up streams to spawn. In North America, all lampreys spawn in spring or early summer. Males begin building a nest and are joined later by females. Using their oral discs to lift stones and pebbles and vigorous body vibrations to sweep away light debris, they form an oval depression at spawning, with the female attached to a rock to maintain her position over the nest. A male attaches to the dorsal side of her head. As eggs are shed into the nest, they are fertilized by the male. The sticky eggs adheres to pebbles in the nest and becomes lightly covered with sand. Adults die soon after spawning process in these fishes. This is the last slide showing the fish group without swim bladder, and these are known as hagfishes, which are also the jawless fishes. Hagfishes are renowned for their ability to generate enormous quantities of slime. If disturbed or roughly handled, a hagfish exudes a milky fluid from special glands positioned along its body. On contact with seawater, the fluid forms a slime so slippery that the animal is almost impossible to grasp. Hagfish are an entirely marine group that feeds on annelids, mollusks, crustaceans, and dead or dying animals. There are about 70 species of hagfishes, of which the best known in North America are the Atlantic hagfish and the Pacific hagfish. Although almost completely blind, hagfishes are quickly attracted to food, especially dead or dying fishes, by their keenly developed senses of smell and touch. A whale that dies and falls to the bottom of the ocean attracts thousands of hagfishes who feed on the dead body for several years. Now the question arises why sharks do not have swim bladder and how they can maintain their buoyancy without having swim bladder, as like the bony fishes have. The answer of this question lies in this slide. We will discuss it one by one. As the sharks and rays have several differences from other fish, for one, bony fish have a specialized organ called a swim bladder that helps them swim, while sharks do not. However, sharks have several other methods of controlling their buoyancy and level within the water column. This includes several physical adaptations that we will discuss here in these points, like they have a buoyant liver. Sharks lack a swim bladder, but their liver can provide some of the same functions. A shark's liver contains high level of oily lipids. This gives the sharks more or less neutral buoyancy, meaning the shark has rough the same density as seawater. Having neutral buoyancy relative to the seawater makes it easier for the shark to swim about the same level within the water column. And the second adaptation of sharks is they have pectoral fins, which acts like power steering. Sharks also use their pectoral or side fins to control their swimming level. A shark's pectoral fins work like a bird's wings, allowing it to control its level within the water. When swimming, the shark's tail or caudal fin generates forward movement, and the fins generate lift by moving water more rapidly over the top of the fins than underneath, generating lift. Additionally, sharks can dive by pitching their pectoral fins forward. The third advantage of not having a swim bladder is that sharks do not have danger of rupturing the swim bladder. A shark's liver and pectoral fins can provide buoyancy, as well as a shark's liver does have several disadvantages too compared to swim bladders. Bony fish can adjust their swim bladders more precisely than sharks, allowing them to more control of their depth. Additionally, this means that sharks have to spend more energy to rise or fall in the water, and they cannot hover in the water like many bony fish. But the third advantage lies in this slide, that they do not have danger of rupturing of swim bladder. A shark's liver and pectoral fins offer several advantages over swim bladders. For example, a swim bladder can rupture if a fish changes depth too quickly. This limits how quickly a fish can change depth or even how deep a fish can dive. A shark's liver does not suffer from this limitation, allowing sharks to swim to various depths more quickly without injury. If we talk about the structure of a swim bladder, the swim bladder normally consists of two gas-filled sacs located in the dorsal portion of the fish between the gut and the kidneys. Although in a very few primitive fishes there is only a single sac, it has flexible walls that contract or expand according to the ambient or nearby pressure. The walls of the swim bladder contains very few blood vessels and are lined with guanine crystals, which make them impermeable to gases. By adjusting the gas pressurizing organ using the gas gland or oval window, the fish can obtain neutral buoyancy and ascend and descend to a large range of depths. This slide is showing the structure and position of a swim bladder. The swim bladder is a sac-like structure which is present between the gut and the kidneys of a fish, and it has two small segments which are joined together. The swim bladder in a fish varies greatly in structure, size and shape. It is essentially a tough sac-like structure with an overlying capillary network. Beneath the capillary system, there is a connective tissue layer called tunica externa. Below this layer lies the tunica interna, which consists of primarily smooth muscle fibers and epithelial gas gland. The swim bladder lies below the kidneys, between the gonads and above the gut. The connection with the esophagus may be retained throughout the life or may be lost in the adult. The gas secreted by the swim bladder is mostly oxygen, nitrogen, and little quantity of carbon dioxide is also present. Now, depending on the presence of duct, which is the ductus pneumaticus, between the swim bladder and the esophagus, the swim bladder in fishes can be divided into two broad categories, that is physostomous and physocristi types. Depending on the condition of the swim bladder, the teleosts are classified by older taxonomists into two groups, physostomi and physocristi. A transitional condition is observed in eels. In physostomous or soft-rayed fishes, the swim bladder has a connection between the swim bladder and the gut by a duct known as pneumatic duct or ductus pneumaticus, allowing the fish to fill up the swim bladder by gulping air. Excess gas can be removed in a similar manner, and the examples of physostomous fishes are beakers, carps, trouts, herrings, catfish and lungfishes. So we can say that physostomous are the fishes that have a pneumatic duct connecting gas bladder to the alimentary canal. This allows the gas bladder to be filled or emptied via mouth. Now we will discuss about the physocristi condition, which is exhibited by the spiny rayed fishes like eel. In this condition, the pneumatic duct that connects guts and gas bladder is present in the embryos of the fish, but it is lost during development. Collectively, fishes that lack a connection between gas bladder and the alimentary canal, with the bladder serving only as buoyant organ. In these fishes, the connection is lost by pneumatic duct, so their gas gland has to introduce gas, usually oxygen, to the bladder to increase its volume and thus increase buoyancy. In order to introduce gas into the bladder, the gas gland of these fishes excretes lactic acid and produces carbon dioxide, which results in acidity. And due to this acidity, the hemoglobin of the blood is lost its oxygen. Therefore, this effect is known as Root effect. When hemoglobin loses its oxygen, this effect is termed as Root effect, which then diffuses partly into the swim bladder. The oxygen which is released from the blood is partly diffused into the swim bladder of the fish. And this mechanism is present in these physocolistae condition to cope up with the situation of lacking the ductus pneumaticus. This is the diagram showing the swim bladder of these two different groups of fishes. The left side is showing the physostomus condition, while the right side is showing the physocolistae condition. In physostomus condition, there is a connection retained by ductus pneumaticus, as you can see in the last diagram, and there is a connection between the swim bladder and the alimentary canal. But in case of physocolistae condition, this connection is lost, and in order to introduce the gas into the swim bladder, the gas gland provides this kind of gas in the swim bladder. There is no connection between the swim bladder and the alimentary canal, as the ductus pneumaticus is lost in this case or in this condition. Now, if we talk about the composition of gases in the swim bladder, the composition of gases varies in the swim bladder. For example, the white fish Coregonus from deep water has almost pure nitrogen in its gas bladder. Such gas concentrations that differ radically from those of the blood speak further for active cellular gas secretion from the gland into the gas bladder rather than for accumulation of gas by dissociation of oxygen from arterial blood in the reti capillaries. And the fishes from deep waters in general fill the gas bladder mostly with oxygen, as sea robins are lured from shallow into deeper water. The percentage of oxygen in their gas bladder increases from 16% at 1 meter to 50% at 8 meters. And at 175 meters, 87% oxygen occurs in the gas bladder of conger eel. So, in the shallow water fish, the ratios closely approximate than that of the atmosphere, while deep sea fish tend to have higher percentages of oxygen. As I already have told you that the white fish is the example which from deep water has almost pure nitrogen in its gallbladder. For instance, the eel Cynephobranchus has been observed to have 75.1% oxygen, 20.5% nitrogen and 3.1% carbon dioxide and 0.4% argon in its swim bladder, which is also considered as a noble gas. Now we are going to talk about the functions of swim bladder. Among the important functions assigned to the swim bladder, following six are the some of the most important functions which are performed by swim bladder in fish. The first one is phonation or sound production. Second one is hydrostatic, acts as a hydrostatic organ. Third one is acts like adjustable float. Fourth function is maintaining proper center of gravity. Fifth one is respiration in fish. And the last one is acts like a resonating organ. We will discuss these functions in the upcoming slides one by one. The first function of swim bladder is phonation. The concept that fishes are mute has been dispelled by hydrophone recordings at many depths, where many different species of fishes and some of their invertebrate food organisms have been shown to produce sound. Only a few hundred out of the more than 20,000 fish species have so far been clearly identified as sound producers, and there are three general types of sonic mechanisms which are present in fish. These are discussed in this slide in the last three points, that are stridulatory, hydrodynamic and gas bladder involvement. The first one is stridulatory, which means that producing the sound by friction of teeth, and this mechanism is exhibited by grunts, fin spines or bones of the fish. While the second mechanism, that is hydrodynamic, resulting from swimming movements, especially from rapid changes in direction or velocity. And the third or last mechanism, which involves gas bladder, is that the gas bladder is directly involved in making sounds in such fishes as the drums, the grenadiers and the gurnards, where striated muscles originating on the dorsal body wall and inserted on the gas bladder wall vibrate. In the toad fishes, striated muscles in the bladder itself produce rapid volume of changes, resulting in audible signals. The sound producing muscular gas bladder of the toad fishes is so self-contained that it can be taken out and made to produce sound by electrical stimulation. Sounds produced by the gas bladder usually have low frequencies, whereas sounds may be made by the teeth or other bony parts tends to be higher pitched. In most species where the gas bladder emits sounds either through its own special modification or through adjacent structures, the sounds are significant in breeding behavior or in the defense of territories. However, sounds of problematical significance can be elicited mostly under stress from many more species of fishes than have been shown to have elaborate breeding or territorial behavior. Thus, for instance, highly excited minnows, loaches and eels produce high-pitched sounds by release of air from bladder through the pneumatic duct. Herrings in nets have been heard to expel gas from their gas bladders through a duct that ends at the anus. The circumstances under which these sounds are produced implicates them as warning sounds. In the deep sea fishes, specific sounds which are species specific may be unusually significant because light other than bioluminescence is absent. And the swim bladder helps in production of sound. Many fishes, like you can see in this slide, Doras, Platystoma and Malapterurus and Trigla, can produce drumming sound. Vibrations of incomplete septa vary mechanisms of sound productions in various species. These may be stridulatory, hydrodynamic and gas bladder involvement. This is the example of fish which produce sounds, and this is the Trigla fish. Now the question arises why sharks do not have swim bladder and how they can maintain their buoyancy without having swim bladder, as like the bony fish. This is the third fish, Pseudoplatystoma, which also produces sounds in various situations. And this is the last example from this slide of the fish having sound production. And this fish is Malapterurus. The gas bladder of a fish also acts as hydrostatic organ. It is primarily a hydrostatic organ. It helps to keep the weight of the body equal to the volume of the water the fish displaces. It also serves to equilibrate the body in relation to the surrounding medium by increasing or decreasing the volume of gas content. In the physostomous fishes, the expulsion of the gas from the swim bladder is caused by way of the ductus pneumaticus, but in the physocolistis fishes, the ductus pneumaticus is absent, so the superfluous gas is removed by diffusion process. As the density of fish flesh is greater than that of water, so in order to be completely weightless and to expend a minimum of energy in maintaining position, the fish may lay down fats and oils in muscle and liver, or it may use a gas inclusion to reduce its overall weight. The gas bladder of bony fishes is such an organ and has as one of its functions that of bringing the overall density of fish closely to that of the surrounding water. Lampreys and hagfishes, the sharks, squids and rays and their relatives, and the living coelacanth like Latimeria do not have gas bladders. The sharks and rays are suspected to regulate body buoyancy by means of adjusting the water ballast contained in the body cavity and operated through their abdominal pores. The gas bladder among fishes may make up between 4 and 11% of the body volume, 4 to 6% for marine fishes and 7 to 11% for freshwater ones, the difference being accounted for by the density differences of the two media. The division of fishes into physostomous and physocolistae has a functional as well as morphological basis. There is gradual but not abrupt change from one to the other condition as concerns gas secreting and resorbing structures, and in the adults of many physostomous species the gas bladder loses the pneumatic duct that connected it to the outside in the juveniles or young. This condition is called paraphysocolistis and is found, for example, in the mid-depth lantern fishes. The third important function of swim bladder is it acts like adjustable float. By adjusting specific gravity of the fish, the swim bladder of the fish also acts as an adjustable float to enable the fishes to swim at any depth with the least effort. When a fish likes to sink, the specific gravity of the body is increased, and when it ascends, the swim bladder is distended and the specific gravity is diminished. By such adjustment, a fish can maintain an equilibrium at any level. The swim bladder of fish also maintains a proper center of gravity. The swim bladder of the fish helps to maintain the proper center of gravity by shifting the contained gas from one part of it to the other part. So this facility is exhibited by a variety of movements. This is the most important function of the swim bladder, that is respiration. The respiratory function of the swim bladder is quite significant. In many fishes living in water in which oxygen content is considerably low, the oxygen produced in the bladder may serve as a source of oxygen. In a few fishes, especially in the dipnuans, the swim bladder becomes modified into the lungs, and these lungs are capable of taking atmospheric air. So many physostomous fishes use the gas bladder as a temporary or supplementary organ of respiration. So, for example, the giant redfish of the Amazon is one of the largest freshwater bony fishes and attains some 5 meters, and it lives or resides in, and it can attain a maximum of 200 kg weight. It also lives in swamps and has the gas bladder particularly well developed for aerial respiration. The gars, the bow fin, some more myriads, and the feather tail are additional examples of facultative air breathers with a highly sacculated or alveolar lining in the gas bladder. These fishes can survive in water which is devoid of oxygen, if enabled to swallow air, which then can pass into the gas bladder via the pneumatic duct, or in some can pass out of the gas bladder by an opening at the anus. The relative importance of air breathing by the bovine, which lives in the temperate regions of North America, depends also on the temperature of the water. When water temperature reaches 20 to 25 degrees centigrade, the fish regularly ascend for air, even in well aerated water. Since the gas bladder in Physostomus fishes always contains more carbon dioxide than the air, it has been suggested that elimination of this waste gas is performed there also, but the extent of this function is not known. This is the last function of the swim bladder, that is it acts like a resonator or sound conducers. The swim bladder is regarded to act as a resonator. It intensifies the vibrations of sound and transmits these to the ear through the Weberian ossicles, which is also known as Weberian apparatus. Weberian apparatus is a distinctive chain of small bones which are characteristics of fish of the superorder Osteriophysi, which includes carps, caracins, minnows, suckers, loaches, catfish and others. The Weberian apparatus consists of four pairs of bones called ossicles, derived from the vertebrae immediately following the skull. The bones link the swim bladder and inner ear and serve to enhance hearing by conducting pressure changes produced by externally originating sound waves from the swim bladder to the ear. The density of fish flesh is so nearly equal to that of sea water that the animal would be virtually transparent to sound. If it were not for bone and the gas bladder that provide acoustical discontinuities based on their difference of densities from that of water, both bone and gas bladder may act therefore as sound conducers or resonators. In certain group of fishes, the gas bladder may extend into the region of the inner ear, and variations in pressure due to sound waves may be transmitted directly to the perilymph. Thus, in the cords and the porges, an anterior extension of the gas bladder touches the head bones near the sacculus of the inner ear. In the herrings, extensions of the gas bladder grow into cartilaginous capsules in close opposition to the perilymph spaces of the superior and inferior portions of the inner ear. A similar condition is found in the cichlid atropellus. The spriniform fishes have a wide range of sound perception and better sound discrimination than that of the fishes that lack the Weberian apparatus. Elimination of the gas bladder in the minnows greatly reduces the auditory range. In fishes that do not have the Weberian ossicles, bony elements of the pectoral girdle or the skull may abut the gas bladder. In the squirrel fishes and the trigger fishes, these bony connectives probably play a role in sound production. In this slide, you can see the Weberian apparatus of fishes, which is a specialized auditory structure and one of the most notable complex system in teleost fish, especially in the order spriniforms. It is a mechanical device which improves audition, and it consists of a double chain of ossicles joining to the air bladder to the inner ear, and it comprises of four bony elements or Weberian ossicles, as you can see here the numbering of these in Roman numerals 1, 2, 3 and 4. These are the Weberian ossicles, and there is a connection between the Weberian ossicles and the perilymph, and the inner ear is connected to the perilymph. So in this way, first of all, there is a swim bladder to which the Weberian ossicles are connected, and from these Weberian ossicles there is a connection of perilymph, and this perilymph joins the inner ear of the fish, so it helps in audition of sound
in most of the teleost fishes, like in the order of spiriniforms.
The gas bladder of a fish also acts as a hydrostatic organ. It is primarily a hydrostatic organ. It helps to keep the weight of the body equal to the volume of the water the fish displaces. It also serves to equilibrate the body in relation to the surrounding medium by increasing or decreasing the volume of gas content. In the physostomous fishes, the expulsion of the gas from the swim bladder is caused by way of the ductus pneumaticus. Now, the swim bladder may be present or absent in some fishes, like in jawless fishes such as lampreys and hagfishes, as well as the cartilaginous fishes such as sharks, skates and rays. Swim bladder is totally absent. But in case of bony fishes, swim bladder is present, with few exceptional cases such as flat fishes.
The third conclusion is that the effect of increased pressure in the surrounding water is to increase both the percentage of oxygen and carbon dioxide in the swim bladder. If carbon dioxide is increased in the medium in which perch are living, the volume of the fishes is changed and the fishes automatically rise in the water. This response would be of adaptive value, causing the fish to move out of deeper water containing larger amounts of carbon dioxide into the safer zones above. The primary function of the swim bladder of most of the freshwater fishes is hydrostatic, and the perch apparently possess no voluntary muscular control over the size of the swim bladder. Under conditions where high oxygen percentages were found in the swim bladder, a higher tension of the gases existed than in the blood. This indicates an active secretion.
The gas bladder of a fish also acts as a hydrostatic organ. It is primarily a hydrostatic organ. It helps to keep the weight of the body equal to the volume of the water the fish displaces. It also serves to equilibrate the body in relation to the surrounding medium by increasing or decreasing the volume of gas content. In the physostomous fishes, the expulsion of the gas from the swim bladder is caused by way of the ductus pneumaticus. But in the physocolistous fishes, the ductus pneumaticus is absent, so the superfluous gas is removed by diffusion process. As the density of fish flesh is greater than that of water, so in order to be completely weightless and to expend a minimum of energy in maintaining position, the fish may lay down fats and oils in muscle and liver, or it may use a gas inclusion.
Now we will discuss about human uses of swim bladder. Fishes such as sturgeons, hake, conger, pike, croaker and carp commands high price for its fish maw, and the reason is that these fishes have large and developed air bladders. Male fishes' air bladder is thicker and thus command a higher price. If is a winter caught fish, its fish maw would also be more expensive than usual fish. So in some Asian cultures, the swim bladder of certain large fishes are considered as a food delicacy. In China, they are known as fish maw, and they are served in soups or stews, which I will show you in the next slides. The vanity price of a vanishing kind of maw is behind the imminent extinction of the vaquita, the world's smallest dolphin species, found only in Mexico's Gulf of California. The once numerous vaquita are now critically endangered. Vaquita die in gill nets set to catch totoaba, the world's largest drum fish. Totoaba are being hunted to extinction for its maw, which can sell for as much $10,000 per kg. Swim bladders are also used in the food industry as a source of collagen, They can be made into a strong water-resistant glue or used to make isinglass for the clarification of beer. This slide is showing the image of stews. The primary function of the swim bladder of most of the freshwater fishes is hydrostatic, and the perch apparently possess no voluntary muscular control over the size of the swim bladder. Under conditions where high oxygen percentages were found in the swim bladder, a higher tension of the gases exist. Vacuita is a species of porpoise which is endemic to Gulf of California and averaging 150 cm for females or 140 cm for males in length. It is the smallest of all cetaceans. Today the species is on the brink of extinction. Recent researchers estimate that the population of this vacuita fish is less than 19 individuals. The steep decline in abundance is primarily due to bycatch in gill nets from the illegal Totuapa fishery. In this slide, the fish maw is shown, which is a highly prized product of swim bladder. International prices for dry maw range between $450 and $1,000 per kg, depending on the size, quality and market strength. The swim bladder of Totoaba fish enables to maintain its buoyancy in the water, but it is used in traditional medicines in China, and many people believe that it can cure ailments such as arthritis.